Since it was written down in the ancient scroll of Ezekiel, ostensibly during the Babylonian captivity, the vision attributed to the prophet Ezekiel of the heavens opening, permitting him, quote, visions of God, has inspired wonder, as well as discussion and debate. Artists have attempted to depict the vision described, which includes a whirlwind, a great cloud, a fire enfolding itself, and wheels in the middle of wheels, covered all over with eyes. More recently, a different interpretation has been offered, which proposes that Ezekiel saw some kind of advanced flying ship or spacecraft and attempted to describe it using the best descriptions he had available. In the first half of the 20th century, for example, the so-called sleeping prophet Edgar Cayce said that what Ezekiel describes were Atlantean airships from a time long before the 6th century BC. While in the book Chariots of the Gods, first published in 1968, Eric von Daniken confidently declares that Ezekiel was describing, quote, a craft that comes from the north, emitting rays and gleaming and raising a gigantic cloud of desert sand, end quote, and that the wheels within wheels were, quote, one of those special vehicles the Americans use in the desert and swampy terrain, end quote. Von Daniken also describes the craft as a multi-purpose vehicle, say, an amphibious helicopter. In 1974, another author, Joseph F. Blumrich, published a book entitled The Spaceships of Ezekiel, in which he claims he set out to disprove or debunk von Daniken's proposition regarding the vision of Ezekiel, but instead, upon closer examination, became convinced that the descriptions in Ezekiel were indeed eyewitness accounts of a workable spaceship. All of these attempts to make sense of the vision of Ezekiel fall into the trap of reading the text literally, as if Ezekiel were a literal and historical human figure who lived during the 6th century BC and described something that he saw in literal history with his own eyes, when in fact, there's abundant evidence that the vision of Ezekiel is actually a sophisticated metaphor based upon the heavenly cycles created by the motions of the sun, moon, stars, visible planets, and especially the constellations, with the zodiac constellations playing a leading role. In this video, we'll see evidence that the vision of Ezekiel describes a sophisticated vision of the heavenly cycles and of the mighty celestial machinery which drives them, even as it cloaks this description in metaphorical and fantastical or mythical imagery. Here is the text of the vision of Ezekiel found in chapter 1 of the scroll or book of Ezekiel. Now it came to pass in the 30th year, in the 4th month, in the 5th day of the month, as I was among the captives by the river Kebar, that the heavens were opened and I saw visions of God. In the 5th day of the month, which was the 5th year of King Jehoiakim's captivity, the word of the Lord came expressly unto Ezekiel the priest, the son of Buzi, in the land of the Chaldeans, by the river Kebar, and the hand of the Lord was there upon him. And I looked, and behold, a whirlwind came out of the north, a great cloud, and a fire enfolding itself, and a brightness was about it, and out of the midst thereof, as the color of amber, out of the midst of the fire. Also, out of the midst thereof came the likeness of 4 living creatures, and this was their appearance. They had the likeness of a man. And every one had 4 faces, and every one had 4 wings, and their feet were straight feet, and the sole of their feet was like the sole of a calf's foot, and they sparkled like the color of burnished brass. And they had the hands of a man under their wings on their 4 sides, and they 4 had their faces in their wings. Their wings were joined one to another. They turned not when they went. They went every one straight forward. As for the likeness of their faces, they four had the face of a man, and the face of a lion on the right side, and they four had the face of an ox on the left side. They four also had the face of an eagle. Thus were their faces, and their wings were stretched upward. Two wings of every one were joined to another, and two covered their bodies, and they went every one straight forward. Whither the Spirit was to go, they went, and they turned not when they went. As for the likeness of the living creatures, their appearance was like burning coals of fire, and like the appearance of lamps. It went up and down among the living creatures, and the fire was bright, and out of the fire went forth lightning. And the living creatures ran and returned as the appearance of a flash of lightning. Now as I beheld the living creatures, behold, one wheel upon the earth by the living creatures with his four faces. The appearance of the wheels and their work was like unto the color of a beryl. And they four had one likeness, and their appearance and their work was, as it were, a wheel in the middle of a wheel. When they went upon their four sides, and they turned not when they went. As for their rings, they were so high that they were dreadful, and their rings were strakes. Were full of eyes round about them four. And when the living creatures went, the wheels went by them. And when the living creatures were lifted up from the earth, the wheels were lifted up. Whithersoever the Spirit was to go, they went. Thither was their spirit to go. And the wheels were lifted up over against them, for the spirit of the living creature was in the wheels. And the likeness of the firmament upon the heads of the living creature was as the color of the terrible crystal stretched forth over their heads above. And under the firmament were their wings straight, the one toward the other. Every one had two, which covered on this side, and every one had two, which covered on that side, their bodies. And when they went, I heard the noise of their wings like the noise of great waters, as the voice of the Almighty, the voice of speech, as the noise of a host. When they stood, they let down their wings, and there was a voice from the firmament that was over their heads when they stood and had let down their wings. And above the firmament that was over their heads was the likeness of a throne, as the appearance of a sapphire stone, and upon the likeness of the throne was the likeness as the appearance of a man above upon it. And I saw the color of amber, as the appearance of fire round about within it, from the appearance of his loins even upward, and from the appearance of his loins even downward, I saw as it were the appearance of fire, and it had brightness round about, as the appearance of the bow that is in the cloud in the day of rain, so was the appearance of the brightness round about. This was the appearance of the likeness of the glory of the Lord. And when I saw it, I fell upon my face, and I heard a voice of one that spake. This is an armillary sphere. It's a model of the celestial mechanics as they appear to an observer on earth, but built so that we can observe their turnings from a point of view outside of the earth. Note that it envisions the components of the celestial motions in the form of rings, rings within rings, in fact. The very word armillary actually comes from a Latin word for a ring. Let's see how an armillary sphere depicts the heavenly cycles using these rings. When we go out and observe the heavens, the sun and stars appear to rotate across the sky each day due to the rotation of our planet on its axis. As we progress around the sun on our annual orbit, the background of stars that we see at any given time of night, or day if we were able to see the stars during the day, changes due to our position on our orbit around the sun. It's as if the Earth is walking in a circle around the sun, walking in circles around the sun. The background, as we walk in a circle around the sun, the background that we see behind the sun will change based on our circular motion around that sun. One way of understanding the model of an armillary sphere is to imagine the sun's position in the sky at noon each day. As we go through the year, the sun's position at noon will be higher in the summer and lower in the winter, because the arc the sun takes across the sky is higher in the summer and lower in the winter. It's a function of our Earth's axial tilt. If we could remove the horizon and see all the way down to the south celestial pole, we would have a view something like this. 90 degrees up from the south celestial pole, or 90 degrees down from the north celestial pole, which is behind our heads in this image here, is this line that we call the celestial equator. 90 degrees up from the south celestial pole, 90 degrees down from the north celestial pole. The sun's path across the sky will be above that line during the day in the months from spring equinox to summer solstice to autumn or fall equinox, and below that line in the months from autumn or fall equinox to winter solstice to spring equinox. It'll still be above the horizon, of course. If we're not in the Arctic or Antarctic circle, the sun still comes up and crosses the sky in the winter, but it'll just be a lot lower in the sky, closer to the horizon. The armillary sphere models this motion by showing a ring for the celestial equator, and also showing the path of the sun as another ring, which goes above and below the celestial equator, crossing at the points of the two equinoxes. If we imagine ourselves in the middle of the armillary sphere, inside of those rings, standing on the little globe, looking towards the southern horizon with the north celestial pole behind our heads, just as it was in the previous animation when we looked towards the south, we can see that the wide ring or band of the ecliptic through which the sun crosses the sky shows the path of the sun and also the background constellation of the zodiac through which the sun is traveling at any given point throughout the year. As the Earth goes around the sun during the year, the sun actually has a different zodiac constellation as its background stars from the point of view of an observer on Earth. But the four most important of these background constellations in any precessional age are the four which mark the points of the spring equinox, the summer solstice, the fall equinox, and the winter solstice, the points where the sun either crosses that celestial equator or gets to its highest and lowest point above or below the celestial equator. These are shown on the armillary sphere by these four hoops or couleurs, these vertical rings, which indicate the sun's position in the zodiac sign it travels through on the highest point, the lowest point, and its two crossing points throughout the year. During the present epoch, these constellations are about to shift to a new set of constellations, but during the age of Pisces, they were Pisces at the spring equinox, Gemini for the summer solstice, Virgo for the fall equinox, and Sagittarius for the winter solstice. However, back in the age of Taurus, previous to the age of Aries, which is previous to the age of Pisces, they were Taurus, the bull for the spring equinox, Leo, the lion, for the summer solstice, Scorpio for the fall equinox, and Aquarius, the water bearer, for the winter solstice. Do those signs, do those constellations, those heavenly figures sound familiar? Those are the four signs described in the vision of Ezekiel. The lion, the bull, the eagle, which corresponds to Scorpio, we'll see in a moment, and the man is Aquarius, the water bearer. So the vision of Ezekiel is actually describing the signs at the four critical points in the celestial mechanics during the age of Taurus, which means that the vision harkens back to a time previous to the age of Aries, which was the age previous to the age of Pisces, which means that the imagery in this passage harkens back to a very remote period of antiquity, prior to at least 2100 BC and probably far earlier even than that. And there is abundant evidence that this system of celestial metaphor that's found in the myths and scriptures around the world is extremely ancient. Note that instead of using the constellation Scorpio in the vision of Ezekiel, an eagle is used instead. Directly above Scorpio, following along the Milky Way, we find the constellation of Aquila, the eagle, which is sometimes substituted for Scorpio in some ancient stories, particularly in the Bible. I'm not sure if this was done out of preference of imagery, or if perhaps this is another indication of extreme antiquity of the system of metaphor, and perhaps the eagle was more easily visible above the horizon at some point in the past. I suspect it has more to do with the preference for using an eagle rather than a scorpion in some sacred stories or scriptural episodes. I propose that the evidence in the text demonstrates that the vision of Ezekiel describes, in esoteric language and imagery, the very same celestial machinery which is modeled for us in the rings within rings or wheels within wheels of an armillary sphere. When the text says that something seen is in the likeness of a throne, or the likeness of a man, or the likeness of the faces of an ox or a lion, or the likeness of anything else, it is almost certainly referring to the likeness that we see in the constellations in the heavens, which have the likeness of those characters or creatures or objects. The likeness of the living creatures in this passage, of course, correspond to the constellations Taurus, Leo, Aquila, and Aquarius, the stars of which have the likeness of a bull and a lion and an eagle and a man in the heavens. Their appearance is also described in the text as having the appearance of burning coals or of lamps, which certainly is a good description for the stars in the sky, and particularly for these constellations, each of which contains a very bright star, except for Aquarius, which doesn't contain a bright star itself, but is directly above a very bright star. So saying that their appearance is like lamps or like burning coals is a strong clue that we're talking about important constellations here. An additional clue is found in the phrase, which is repeated several times about the living creatures, that they went straight forward and turned not when they went. The stars and the constellations do indeed go straight forward across the sky and do not turn back in their progress. That's in contrast to the motion of the visible planets, all of which can be seen to display what is known as retrograde motion periodically, which is a function of the fact that the Earth is passing them on its orbit, as we all orbit the sun, which makes a planet seem to reverse direction periodically from the perspective of an observer on Earth. If you look closely at the planets Venus and Mercury, which are always seen to be close to the Sun itself in this video from the planetarium, you can see them displaying retrograde motion from time to time, fairly frequently. And you can also see Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn display retrograde motion as well. That means that we cannot say of the planets that they go straight forward or that they turn not when they go. We can say that of the stars in the constellations, such as the stars in Taurus and Leo and the other zodiac constellations, but we can't say that about the planets. So the fact that the text is saying that about the living creatures is another clue in the text itself, which helps us decipher the esoteric imagery. The descriptions of the wheels, which are also called rings in some places in the text, makes it fairly clear that the text is talking about the very same rings that we see modeled in an armillary sphere. One is described as being upon the earth, that's in Ezekiel 1 verse 15, and one is described as going up and down, and as being lifted up from the earth, lifted up so high that it is dreadful. These descriptions almost certainly refer to the wheel or ring of the celestial equator. The wheel or ring that goes up and down and achieves a dreadful height refers to the ecliptic band, which yawns open above the celestial equator and above the horizon on earth like a great mouth, reaching its greatest height at summer solstice before closing again and plunging down towards winter solstice. These rings are described in Ezekiel 1 verse 18 as being full of eyes, which almost certainly means full of stars. And the ecliptic band, which contains the zodiac constellations, can very accurately be described as being full of stars, and indeed as being full of eyes when we see them as the various constellations. There's also a very important term used in the text for this ring that rises up so high and that's full of eyes, and that word is strakes. The text actually says that the strakes are full of eyes. The word strake is a technical term that's not used very much in our modern era, but it refers to the segments of a wagon wheel that's made up of wooden sections, like this wagon wheel that you see here. These segments are called strakes. You can see that the metaphor of a straked wagon wheel is actually an excellent metaphor to describe the zodiac band, which can be envisioned as being made up of segments or strakes belonging to each zodiac sign. The presence of this word strakes in verse 18 is a very strong piece of evidence confirming that the interpretation of this vision as describing the motions of the ecliptic band relative to the celestial equator and the other heavenly wheels or rings is indeed a correct interpretation. There are many other aspects of the vision of the heavens described by Ezekiel which could be discussed and matched up with features in the night sky, including numerous references to the Milky Way band, which is described as a river, as a cloud, as a brilliant fire, and even as a bow arching across the heavens. However, there's one other important source of additional confirmatory evidence, and that's found in the writings left by ancient church leaders, including Augustine, Jerome, and Irenaeus. In the early 1800s, the brilliant and insightful Robert Taylor, a pioneer of what has come to be called Astrotheology, noticed that the ancient church leader Irenaeus declared that the Gospels must be four in number because the zones of the earth are four in number. Robert Taylor realized that Irenaeus was not talking about zones of terrestrial geography, but rather that he was talking about the four seasons of the year, which are indicated by the zodiac signs that preside over the summer and winter solstices and the spring and fall equinoxes. Irenaeus then went on to articulate the first known argument that the new Testament gospel accounts of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John each correspond to a season of the year, as well as to one of these same four living creatures that we've been discussing, the lion, the eagle, the ox, and the man. Robert Taylor realized that this argument by Irenaeus, which was echoed with some variations by Jerome and by Augustine, provides powerful evidence that the four creatures described in the scroll of Ezekiel and later associated with the gospel accounts correspond to the spring, summer, winter, and fall, and to the solstices and equinoxes. The irony of this situation was not lost on Robert Taylor, for Irenaeus and the other early theologians were some of the staunchest defenders and proponents of the literalist interpretation of the biblical scriptures, and some of the most constant opponents of Gnostic or esoteric interpretations of the characters and episodes in the Bible, interpretations which would deny their literal historicity. The argument that they are describing terrestrial history. And yet, as we can see, the vision of Ezekiel is indeed metaphorical and esoteric in nature in describing the motions of the heavens, the celestial cycles, upon which all the world's ancient myths, scriptures, and sacred stories have their foundation. Here's a title page from the 1599 Geneva version of the Bible, in which we see the 12 disciples and the 12 children of Israel arranged around the outer edge of the page, and the four Gospels arranged in the center of the page with one of the four creatures drawn with each Gospel. Whether intentional or not, this arrangement acknowledges the fact that the sun moves or can be seen to move through the 12 signs of the zodiac during the progress of a year, and that these four critical points are indicated in any age by four zodiac constellations corresponding to the spring equinox, the summer solstice, the fall equinox, and the winter solstice. The fact that the ancient myths and scriptures are describing celestial motions using metaphorical language, characters, and stories does not mean that they are, quote, not true. In fact, I would argue that the ancient myths and scriptures of the world's sacred tradition are designed to preserve and convey profound truth of great importance to our lives. I've discussed what I believe some aspects of their message for us may be in many of my books and other writings. And I'm convinced that as we learn to listen to the ancient myths and sacred stories in the language that they are actually speaking, we are better equipped to hear what they are trying to tell us. And that language that they are using is a celestial language based upon the heavenly cycles of the sun, moon, stars, and visible planets, and especially upon the motions and characteristics of the constellations.